I'm just going to start. Yo, hey, everybody, we got Ian Grigg with us today, and I just want to know, for people who don't know, who is Ian Grigg?
I'm a guy who got into the field in 1995. Before it was blockchain, it was digital cash. In the 90s, there was a huge push to do digital cash. The company eCash, DigiCash in Amsterdam was doing eCash. And my company started doing the rest of finance because I figured out that if you can do e-cash, then you could also do e-bonds or you could do e-securities or whatever.
Okay, so you started a company back in you started this concept
1995,
back in 1995, that's
yes,
right.
Yes, that's right. So I had this epiphany that the way bonds work is that they're constructed of many, many dollar notes, which they call zero coupon bonds. They use that atomic element to construct all the mathematics behind bonds. And I realized that if they could do digital cash over in Amsterdam, if they could do dollars on the net, then I could do bonds on the net. So I set up a company to do that. We built the first, if you like, crypto exchange. We didn't call it that in those days, but we were real-time gross settling and trading bonds for cash. So the you'd go there, send up your cash, and back would come the bonds, or vice versa. And this would all happen within a few seconds. So we were doing that in the 90s. Now, I then went through several iterations of that, but it was a tough business to be in until Bitcoin came along and showed how to do it in a decentralized fashion. And then the field started to grow from there. But by then, I was already 10 years along, or even 16 years along in the field, having produced a bunch of different iterations.
So there's some important concept that I think is in the white paper that was one of your inventions. What is it called?
Triple entry accounting.
Triple entry accounting, that's
it. Yes, that came out of the work we did in the 90s. What I was trying to do, I was just explaining that to Peter here. I was trying to avoid having an accounting system because they're deadly boring. And consequently, I designed the system such that it would be rock solid and it would look after itself. And each particular instance, each particular transaction would be represented by the same data that everybody had. We ended up with a situation where the center had a receipt, which it distributed to the two counterparties, the two parties, so that you ended up with three copies of it in the hands of everybody that was important. Hence, 10 years later, I realized, oh gosh, we could, just as a joke, call that triple entry accounting. And okay, so I dashed off a paper in 2 hours, sent it out there, and that became a little bit of a hit. That paper found its way across to Satoshi, who realized that that was actually a way to go forward, establish the transaction as the receipt sitting on the blockchain in this context. So that's how triple entry accounting found its way into the concept of Bitcoin or blockchain.
Did Satoshi reach out to you before they looked
No, didn't. Satoshi was on the cryptography mailing list in 2008 describing the system. And at that time, I didn't realize how the design had been laid out. And I was busy on something else. So I just read the posts and moved on because I was doing a big audit for another organization at the time. Didn't have time to get into that debate, which is a shame, but hey, that's what happens.
So at what point did you connect the dots with Bitcoin and get like involved in
I think probably around 2012 or 2013, I started realizing that it's a triple entry system. I've got a post on my blog that said, yeah, is Bitcoin a triple entry accounting system? And I came to the conclusion that it actually probably was. It just wasn't the triple entry accounting system that I thought things should be done. It was clearly different to my design, but the end result was the same thing. So that was a big epiphany for me. And it was only many years later that I heard the story about how the paper had in fact impacted the design. To close the loop, if you like.
Paper impacted the design. So it wasn't much.
My
and
paper,
how
yes.
Did you hear about that, the impact?
Back in 2015, I started talking to the members of the little secret society known as Satoshi. The first thing that the person I was talking to told me when she entered into the Satoshi group, the first thing that happened to her was they slapped down the paper on triple entry accounting and said, read that. You've got to understand this. You've got to read this and appreciate it, because that's part of the design. So this person knew all about it.
So are you saying there was a secret Satoshi team?
It was a secret team, yes, absolutely. Yeah. But by then it was down to two people. There was only two people left.
But before that, there was a lot of people in it?
So it depends how you count them and which particular year you're talking about. Before Bitcoin came out, it was really a team of three people. And then about 2010, they added the intern who basically did the bits and pieces and security work and so forth. And then 2013, the two guys died. So that reduced it back down to two, from four to two. And depending on how you count it...
Is one of the guys Kleiman?
Yeah, Kleiman. Dave Kleiman died.
Kleiman died.
Yeah. And the old professor died as well.
Who's that?
He's known, but it's kind of... It's not mentioned. It's known around the scene. You'll be able to dig it out, but it's not mentioned because the family was in distress at the claim that this person was part of Bitcoin. So we don't really mention his name.
Fair enough. No. Wow. So that you were really in communication with those guys in the early days then at that point?
Yeah, 2015 onwards, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, but only for a year, because 2016 was the big reveal where Craig goes on stage and talks to the BBC and has an emotional meltdown. And so that, if you like, to me, that was the death of Satoshi. At that point, Satoshi was over. As a team, as a concept, as... You know, a secret society, if you like.
I'll be back.
So it sounds like somebody exposed the team at that point. Was it the Wired magazine?
Yeah, Wired magazine and Gizmodo, I think. They did. They were both working on a hit piece, and there was somebody behind the scenes jogging each of them to publish. And what this person did was said to each of them, the other's about to publish, and managed to get them to go out on one particular day. At the same time as this was happening, the AFP, the Australian Federal Police, were rushing to try and get a warrant to go and seize all the stuff that Craig apparently had. They missed out because he'd moved house at that time, put everything in storage, so they ended up achieving nothing, but it was a dramatic day, if you like. These two articles coming out, and then the AFP rushing to get that warrant to go and seize basically empty buildings.
So, were you there with Andrew O'Hagan when he was, you know, traveling around with the team and
The book
days?
Author?
Yeah, the book author.
No, I wasn't. I knew about it, but I wasn't there. No. I didn't get involved in the big reveal. They tried to employ me to work on it, but I put my foot down and said, no, you're doing the wrong thing. Craig is not a rock star. He will have severe difficulties if you try and turn this into a circus. And unfortunately, the guy who was running that particular circus continued to carry on and run a circus, and Craig had a meltdown. So, but I was definitely well against it and said, you know, this is the wrong thing that you're doing. You've got the wrong idea about who this person is and what capability this person has. So I was definitely against it. So they didn't employ me. They didn't give me a contract to help.
You weren't going to be part of the circus.
No, because I disagreed with the boss, and that's, you know, rule number one. You never disagree with the boss.
So, all right. So now you're here at this conference doing you're talking. What is it that you're really focused on now? Are you talking about the triple entry system?
Not especially the triple entry accounting system. The talk is about governance and regulation and so forth. So I'll probably talk about a couple of things. The first of which is one of the big problems with regulation. They haven't got the right idea. The regulators haven't got the right idea. They're thinking that they can create a set of rules, slap it down on the table, and everybody will follow the rules. They don't have to do that. One of the big things they can do, or should do, is turn around and say to everybody who's in the field, look, where's your contract? What's your contract? The way humans deal with each other is to create contracts between each other. And we write those contracts down if we're professional. So all they should be saying is, look, if you're going to get into this field, write your damn contract down, shove it on the blockchain, you don't need to file it with us, just put it on the blockchain and stick to that contract. And then once you've got that discipline down, that brings you into dispute resolution and jurisdiction, the courts, recompense and all these sort of things. So if you make that step, you get everybody in the blockchain space to start dealing with contracts, then it will evolve in a healthy direction. But the problem, of course, is that the regulators don't understand this. They don't understand contracts and law. And the crazy people in blockchain are trying to avoid getting involved. Yeah, they're seeing it all with the same target, with the same brush. So they're avoiding the good parts as well as the bad parts. And to a large extent, you have to say, a lot of them are just looking for the easy money. So they don't want a contract. They don't want responsibility. But if the regulator was to understand this, let's get a contract out there. Let's force the fact that you have to have a contract. Otherwise, we're going to haul you over the coals, put you into court and make things difficult for you. Yeah. Then you can start to move the industry in a healthy direction. So that's the first point. The second point is that the regulators, again, are working on the notion that, yeah, let's crack some rules and regulations down and make this industry better. There's already a tool to do all this. It's called the trust. So what they should be doing is simply saying, okay, if you are a custody for this stuff, simply put it in a trust. And the trust is this 1,000-year-old mechanism which literally handles assets. That's all it does. So we've got the mechanism, we've got the regulation, we've got the court precedent, all this sitting there. So that would be my second message. Look, guys, wake up. This has been around for 1,000 years. The crypto guys aren't doing anything new. They're just storing assets and occasionally trading them. But that's easy if you've got the
story. Okay, so before you move on, give me more of a background on the trust. How could this trust work for the regulators? Is it for the regulators?
Well,
how would the trust...
It's for everybody.
Okay, for everybody.
Yeah.
So how would it operate?
So to declare my interest here, I work with a company that in fact does this.
Okay, so yeah, how does that
What happens is you come to our company and we will give you an individual trust for your crypto assets. And that means that you send your crypto assets to our platform. It gets uploaded, if you like, into a trust, which is controlled by a trustee. So your assets are no longer yours, but they are held by a trustee. And because the trustee is a serious person, there's a fiduciary duty for that trustee to do the right thing.
Yeah.
So we're not talking about FTX or Mt. Gox or any of those debacles.
No.
We're talking about a professional in the industry of trusts looking after the assets and doing the right thing. So it lifts it up to a high regulated
standard.
Much higher standard.
Actually, that's the highest standard.
It is the highest. It is. It's like banking.
Yeah.
It's as high as banking. And getting
not even
that,
higher. I almost say it's almost a little bit more like strict.
It is. Trust law is extremely strict.
Extremely strong. Now, and the other thing it does, and this is equally important for the world of crypto, is it establishes the jurisdiction as being where the trust is. You, the beneficiary or the settler, you've uploaded your assets into the trust. You are no longer relevant to the equation.
Yeah, you're also not liable anymore, right? Because it's you've
put
gifted.
That's right. You put it into the trust. Mm-hmm. So according to international trust law, the jurisdiction is where the trust is. So that regulator,
if that is international,
takes,
then it's out of
right.
the.
And it's therefore out of your country, and it's in the trust country. Now, what does that mean? Think about Binance. Binance has run around the world trying to establish itself, A, as being nowhere, and B, as trying to get cozy relationships with all the regulators. All of the regulators have taken the position that if you're dealing with our customers, we have to regulate you. But if the customer were to put his assets into a trust, where the trustee takes control, that customer is no longer relevant. So that regulator takes a back seat. It's no longer a problem for them. So now you collapse the 180 countries down to one. Now think about any exchange which is having problems in dozens of countries at any one time. You sweep that away because it's now one country's jurisdiction. Boom. Huge impact. And the thing is, this mechanism has just been sitting there for the last 1,000 years.
Yeah.
Along comes this new class of assets, and they think, well, how are we going to store the assets? Oh, we're going to do keys and fobs, and we're going to do multi-sig, and we're going to have this and that and blah, blah, blah. No, hell no. Put it in a trust, and now you have your legal sorted out, solid. That's so. That's the second part.
Oh,
that will be the second point that I would make when I get out onto the panel.
Oh, this is so needed. This is like so needed.
Well, if you think about the way the regulators and exchanges are going head to head, they're banging heads against each other. What happens if you put them all on a trust basis? Oh, both of them say, "Oh, that was easy.
We don't have jurisdiction." So they immediately
we've used the law to solve the problems for both sides.
Jurisdiction then goes over to the trustee's country.
That's right.
Yeah.
And everybody's happy.
Yeah.
Because you know the regulators are not happy in part because they have to regulate. Now, if you give them the legals that say, "Look, guys, yeah, it's important that we regulate this, but it's not your territory," the regulator would back away and say, "Oh, thank you very much, because you've saved me a hell of a headache."
Yeah.
Because none of these regulators want to go head-to-head with commercial companies. They don't want to go to court and force their will on these companies, especially companies like the crypto companies, who are trying to do crazy things and move forward. They're not strong on the legals. So you just need to give them a proper legal framework. The trust is that. That's the legal framework.
This has been needed for a long time. I mean, is this like the first of its kind? Kind of. I mean,
yes.
Okay.
We are the first of its kind. Yeah. And it's not easy to do this. You need to have a licensed trust provider. And that's a very heavy lift. It's very hard to get a licensed trust provider. You can go to an existing trust provider and talk crypto with them, but they're going to blow you away because they don't want to touch any crazy stuff. They're very conservative. They don't want to do this crazy stuff because they've got their business to protect. It's an extremely reputable business. So you've kind of got to start a new one. And the problem with that, of course, is starting a new licensed trust provider is a big ask. It's like starting a new bank. And you know, here we are in London. Try and start a bank that's crypto-friendly in London. Not a chance in hell. Not a chance. The FCA will totally squash it.
So it sounds like that you or the company has been able to bridge the gap between the trust's understanding about this industry.
Yes, absolutely.
Is this an established trust? This is an established trustee, like a licensed?
Yes, we have a licensed trust company. Yeah, which creates the trusts. It's separated into the licensed trust company and the technical platform. So the technical platform serves the licensed trust company, which then serves the customers with the platform that handles all the mechanics.
So who is your target market?
I think to a large extent, it's people with enough crypto such that it's an administrative nightmare to deal with it. We're not talking about the serious not my keys, not my crypto people. We're not talking about the crypto maximalists. We're talking about the rest of the world who wants to get a bit of crypto. You know, you think about a family office wants to get in some crypto. How do they do it? Well, that's a crazy thing to try and get somebody like a family office to do this. But if you give them a trust, their duty is done. They've done the right thing by putting their crypto in a trust. It's easily handled if you've got a proper company doing this.
Beautiful.
I need to steal him. I need him now, please.
That was great, Ian. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Great to meet you.